Maranatha Fellowship, where we're building lives that make a difference. Construction Zone time. Let's go. Done about 20 songs in 3 minutes. Amen. Come on, Father, we love you and we give you praise, for you are our great God. Thank you for Jesus, our matchless Savior and King, and thank you for your Holy Spirit, for all that you do for us. Thank you for this day that you've brought us through so far, God. You've been good to us. And for that, we are grateful. Now, I pray that you would speak to us now, open up our understanding so that we can be disciples, followers of Jesus Christ, and that we can help others to know you. We give your name glory and honor for Jesus' sake. Amen. All right, so good evening to everybody in person and those of you who are watching online. It's time for our weekly Construction Zone. Praise the Lord. You are in tune to the Magnus Church on two streets in High Point, North Carolina, where we intend to help you reach the high point of your life. Amen. I thank God for Maranatha Fellowship. I like my church. I like a lot of y'all churches too, but I like my church. Amen. So thank you so much for joining us on this evening. The announcement signs is up, so let's see what's happening at Maranatha. Stay in the know. Text the word Maranatha. If you're a new member or you just don't have it yet, text the word Maranatha to 888-249-4235 to stay updated on what we're doing as a church. All right, next one. Women's prayer on Monday, 6:30 in the PM, where the women come together and call on God and sit before him and hear what he has to say. The Bible says men should always pray, and that means everybody. So thank God for the women that keep praying. Amen. Tuesday morning is our prayer call. Now, this is one of those things that is a discipline, and I have to set my alarm because I don't just naturally wake up in time for prayer at 6 a.m. And neither do some of y'all. Don't be looking at me like I'm the only one. So I set my alarm so I can get up. And I think it honors God when you get up and we all pray together for those few minutes in that morning. Then you can go back and catch you a quick little nap before you have to go on. Some of y'all up at 5. So y'all already up and all excited on the call. And we wondering why you so excited. Because you've been up for a minute. Amen. But it's good for us to come together and corporately pray on Tuesday mornings. All right, next one, please. Construction Zone, you in it right now, every Wednesday, 6:30. Praise the Lord. Next, the Safe Space Lounge is happening on Friday. Is that this Friday? Yeah. Yep, this Friday. So there was a sign-up sheet in the vestibule. If you are online and you're going to come in person, then make sure that you put your information in the chat and someone will check that to make sure they get you registered for the Safe Space Lounge. Amen. All right. M3, Maranatha Men. Yeah. That's who we are. That's what's up. We'll be here Saturday at 9:30 for a men's meeting. And there's some bowling that's going to take place later on. Make sure you bring your $14 and go bowl and have a great time. It's time for our men to come together, and we're going to do some significant things on this year, because men should lead. Amen. 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 Marriage maintenance. Woo! Next Friday. Oh, we're going to have a good marriage maintenance, and I'm still pondering exactly what the topic of interest is going to be, but I think I'm going to talk about why you mad. I'm going to talk about why are you mad, because that does not line up with God's will for your life. Why are you mad? Yes, sir. I might even charge y'all for this marriage maintenance. I'm going to wait till you get here, though, so I can charge y'all afterwards. You don't never know, though. No, we wouldn't do it. Yaya is fourth Sunday in April. Thank God for our youth and young adults. We have some amazing children in our church, and I kind of sneak in on the conversation sometimes, but they don't really want the grown folk in there so they can talk openly, which I think is absolutely wonderful. Your children should have a space where they can articulate themselves and talk about certain things, amen, and be safe there. So that's a good thing. So we thank God for Yaya. Click the QR code and register for that. All right, and here it is. We're back. The Heritage is back. Amen. Thank God for Sister Frida and Sister Angel and everybody's putting this together. Our children's ministry is back. Yeah. Amen. We also would like for you to engage in that to help with teaching, monitoring our children. It's going to be a tremendous time. And the kickoff is first Sunday in May. And so if you are a person that has children, you may want to consider volunteering, praise the Lord, to help, because if your children are going to be in there, you can come help with everybody else. It's going to be a great thing. So we're excited about that. So that happens first Sunday in May. All right, the last announcement, if you are a female high school student, there's a scholarship that is available to you that's been made available. It's a $500 scholarship, and I think that there's an essay that you need to write. But you can get the information from off of the screen and apply for that scholarship. Thank you Sister Colette McLaughlin that sent that to us. And I wanted to get that out there to our young ladies that'll be graduating on this year. And by the way, if you have children that are graduating this year, we need to start getting their information immediately, because we got look like we got a big graduating class this year. Amen. So I'm excited for that. Amen. All right. And those are your announcements. Y'all, Angel has been on 12 all year long. Holly done had a significant birthday. She done prom. Now she get ready to graduate. You ain't going to be able to tell Angel nothing until Holly Lee to go to school. And that's when, oh, Lord, I mean, we better all be praying. Amen, amen. Come on, let's get to the Word of God. Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3 and verse number 14. Hey, Gloria Bethay. Rhonda McNeil, I see you. Tamara Neely, I see you. Doris Silverthorn, are you in New York? Where are you? Gwen Davis, Angel Benning is here. Praise God for the saints being online. Y'all like and share and get this out to some more people. Angel, your mama talking about I'm packing following Holly. Lord have mercy. Y'all, somebody can make some money on some real estate wherever that child is. Revelation chapter 3, verse number 14. And to the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things say the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of creation of God. It's Jesus talking here now, y'all. I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. I could wish you were cold or hot. So then because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. Because you say I am rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing, and you do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich, and white garments, that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed. No, I'm going to say that for Sunday. And anoint your eyes with eye salve, that you may see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Therefore, be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and dine with him and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne. Hallelujah. As I also overcame and sat down with my Father. Now, this is really interesting, y'all, because you got to remember James and John's mom came to Jesus. And they said, we want you to let us sit on your right hand, your left. And at that point, he said, that's not mine to give. That was before the resurrection. Ooh, this is good right here. Now he's speaking of his authority as God. And he said, to whom overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne. That's good. As I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. Looks like the key to all of this is overcoming. I know that by grace you're saved through faith. It is the gift of God. I know that when you get saved, it's by the blood. But now it's some other stuff here that you can get saved. But there are a lot of people that don't believe that you can backslide. What I'm also learning is that there are going to be rewards in heaven, and some people are going to get some things, and some people's stuff is going to get burnt up because you didn't overcome. Wow. Mm-hmm. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. All right, so we've been talking about overcoming mediocrity. We talked about what mediocrity is. It's not very good, ordinary, so-so, neither good or bad. And we said that the issue with mediocrity is not being cognizant of time, you don't connect to people in the right way that you should. We said that we only care about ourselves when we're mediocre, and then we minimize our capabilities when we are mediocre. Now, we started talking Sunday about the results of being mediocre. We said that the first result of that was being lukewarm. And that means fluctuating between your love for God and people, not always loving people like you should, having situational love. And this means that it's based on your convenience. So I love you when I feel like loving you, but when I don't, I don't. Love is probably most exemplified when it has been put under pressure. Love is most exemplified when you're trying to love somebody that hates you, that gets on your nerves, that will not cooperate with you, that always has a reason or excuse. How do you keep loving when they lie on you? I didn't hear not one amen, and didn't none of y'all do it in the chat either. Now, how do you know that you can love if the love is never tested? One of the reasons for tests in school is to see if you maintain what you obtain. And so the Bible says, for God so loved the world, here's how his love manifested, that he gave. Now, world, how many of y'all have been saved from birth? Good. Nobody put their hand up in the audience, and I'm glad that nobody put their hand up in the chat. How many of y'all got saved when you were 15? 16? 17? 18. Somebody like, Pastor, come on, get those numbers up. Get those numbers. Here's a better question. How many, when did you get saved for real? Yeah, that's a better question right there. Because my pastor said you can't get saved right on wrong information. And see, some people think they saved because they were baptized and confirmed as a child at the Baptist church. That means you were just wet. Not if you didn't confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. And so sometimes people think that being in church means you saved. But what is Pastor Rice's world famous quote? Being in a garage does not make you a car. And so being in church does not make you saved. Knowing about God does not make you saved. Thinking you a good person does not make you saved. Except a man be born again. If thou wilt confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord. You don't get saved by osmosis just because you came to church and you've been coming. You must confess and believe. And then God will take care of the rest. Amen. Notice Jesus says that I wish you were cold or hot. Man, that's good right there. It tells us we have the ability to do either. But what you should not be is in between. See, this is what we may talk a little bit about on marriage maintenance, especially for some of the singles that are looking to be married. If you got somebody who's wishy-washy, who's in between, if they're not ready, they're not ready. Get out the kitchen. If it ain't ready, it ain't ready. And you looking at it, ain't going to make it ready. Matter of fact, when you start playing with it, you going to mess it up. That's how cakes get messed up. You just keep opening the oven and closing back open. Like, no, if you want it right, let it cook. I'm talking good here now. And you got to get out the way. Move. Get out the way. What's another result of being mediocre? Arrogance. Arrogance. Look at verse 17. Because you say, I am rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing. What's interesting about this is that he wasn't talking to people outside the church. He was talking to people in the church. I wish I had saved this to Sunday, because I believe that this would be one of the moments on Sunday. You can get to a point where you believe your accomplishments or your possessions eliminate your need for faith in God. See, it's one thing when how you gonna pay your rent, all your money spent. When you praying and saying, God, make a way. I need you, Lord. God, just do something. I need some help now. It's different when either you don't have a mortgage or you got plenty of money in the bank to start taking care of some. You find yourself not praying in that area anymore because you believe God already got that covered. Or maybe you believe you got it covered. Arrogance is disgusting to God because it acknowledges a God but acts like you don't need him. Now, how do we see that in church? I'm going to tell you one of the main ways you'll see it in church. Y'all ready? What does your worship look like? See, we're in a generation where people are more excited about trying to hear a word or somebody tickling their ears with something fancy about a life situation to get the word. Oh, and let me wow you with my ability to articulate the scriptures. And we all need a preacher so we can hear. That's what the Bible says. How can they hear without a preacher? So we do need that. But the Bible also says study to show yourself approved unto God. A workman, not pastor, not elder, not missionary, not a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth, which means that I should be home listening to the word, looking up certain things, studying for myself. And then when we come together corporately, there can be a word that can speak to your situation, or something that builds you up, or you know enough word that you can be praying for the person beside you that they can hear God and that the Holy Ghost will speak to them so that they can come into the knowledge of the truth. But now, when you think more of yourself than you do of God, it always shows up in worship. Oh, I'm talking good here now. Because worship is something that you do if you got a million in the bank or if you got a negative balance. Worship is something that you do if you feeling your best or you feeling like you about to die. Worship is something that you do when everything is going right at work or when they've just laid you off. Because regardless of your situation, you deem him as worthy. And when you worship, you stop worrying about who's around you and caring about what they may think about you because of your worship. Man, this is good here. If you go through scripture, when the children of Israel got in the most trouble is when they changed their worship. I'm talking good here now. What happened with Cain and Abel? Abel thought enough of God that he would bring him his best. Cain just brought something and said, here, take whatever it is that I have, because you didn't deem God worthy. Look at what happened with Noah. Noah preached to the people and told them that you're going to rain, we're going to die. And they said, oh no, that's some foolishness. We'll never go with that worship. Noah had enough sense to listen to the voice of God and get his family into the ark of safety. Let me say something again here now. It is not optional for anybody who lives in my house to not go to church. I think I got seven amens on that. You can't live here and not go. go worship the God I serve. Period. As for me. And my, now you can go get your own house. You can go get your own place and handle your stuff and pay your bills and everything else. But I know where my help is coming from. I know who the one is that's taking care of Duke Power. I know who the one is who's taking care of Pete, my natural gas. I know who the one is who has got the city of Greensboro water flowing through here on a monthly basis. I know who the one is where I can go to Food Line. I can go to Half Cedar. Lord God, my wife even got me going to Whole Foods now. I'm talking about, I know the God that provides. His name is Jehovah Jireh. And certainly because of everything he's provided for me, we're going to go and worship. Look at the children of Israel coming out of Egypt. When did the problem start? When they made the golden calf. Because they wanted to make their own God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Because their God was convenient for them. And that is the God of this age. This is the God of convenience for people now. If it's not convenient, I'm not going to do it. If I have to go out of my way in order to seek God, I'm not going to do it. There's another church on another corner, or there's another online program I can watch. So I'm not going to do anything to go out of my way to get God. Certainly not going to witness to other people. Oh, I'm talking good here now. And so when people challenge you like that, now you got a chance to go run and hide because I don't want to deal with that. But they didn't get into trouble until the golden calf showed up. Mm-hmm. If you go read in the book of 2 Kings, when Jeroboam was made king, Solomon messed up, the Bible says, because he loved many women. Brothers, swim in your own pool. Lord, do we have concubines in the 21st century? Husbands, love your wife, singular. I'm talking good here now. Now, when you go play in other people's pools, you don't know what might happen. Solomon, he messed up because he started worshiping Asherah poles and started worshiping the gods of the wives that he had. See, women, y'all don't know how powerful y'all are. Y'all can make men do stuff they normally would not do. Y'all don't want to talk here tonight. I'm about to go home. A woman can cause a man to be stupid. You done got all messed up off of this. Y'all saw Harlem Nights. Come on, sunshine. And so now he worked. Now this is Solomon, who is deemed as the wisest man that ever lived, started worshiping other gods. Because of that, the kingdom was rent. And Rehoboam was the king in Judah. Jeroboam was the king in Israel. Well, Jeroboam didn't want the people to start going back to Judah to worship God because he thought he might start losing constituents. So he made two golden calves. He put one in the north area, I think that was Dan, and one in the southern area. So the people now were going to, and he said, this is your God. The Bible says that a prophet came to him. Oh, my, no. Get it right, Harvey. The Bible says, his son got sick. He sent his wife to the prophet that prophesied to him about him getting the kingdoms to see what was going to happen. The man said, God is going to rend the kingdom from you. He's going to kill everybody in your family. That everybody in your family will either be eaten by dogs in the city or eaten by vultures in the field. And the only one that I'm going to give an honorable death is your son. But he's going to die as soon as you get back home. And y'all want to keep playing with God like he just, y'all forgot about this Old Testament God. Jesus is the only one sitting up there saying, Lord God, please. Now, you know him. You know, we've known them for a long time. And we know how they act. Just have mercy, Lord God. That's why the Bible says goodness and mercy follows me all the days of my life. Because if it didn't, I would have been destroyed. And then we're going to come in here and act like he's just some regular person. And act like we can't lift our hands and we can't open our mouths and we can't give him jubilant joy. That we can't rejoice before him because we're concerned about somebody sitting beside us. Let everything. Hey, I'm closing here now. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. And I feel like we shouldn't wait till Sunday. That we can praise him. Hey, I feel the Holy Ghost. We can praise him on a Wednesday. Tell him how good he's been. How awesome he is. How great he is. He is our God and there's none beside him. Hallelujah. And I don't ever want arrogance and pride to slip in to where we think we something that we can't praise God. Sometimes you're supposed to get some makeup on your clothes. Sometimes you're supposed to let your suit get a little wrinkled. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, we don't even have to worry about that much now in new church because we don't dress up like we used to, so you don't have your best on. But whatever you wear, you ought to be able to pray. Don't ever wear nothing to church you can't praise God in. If you that cute, put it on, take a picture at home, and then change. Hallelujah. He is good to us. I said he is good to us. Boy, Lord, don't get me started here tonight. Your pastor is grateful. And it's going to exude from who I am continually that you won't catch me for any extended period of time not praising God, not worshiping God. Some of y'all need to move towards the front, too. Because when you're in the back, you're watching everybody else. And what you need to be is close and keep your eye on God. I'm talking good here now. You get too distracted in the back and you're watching everything else go on where your face needs to be turned towards the sky and your hands lifted up. Or maybe a tear is coming down your eye. Or maybe you just shout in a circle because of how good God has been to you. And if you say, Pastor, I got some problems right now. Here's one you don't have. If you accepted him as Jesus, one problem you don't have is hell. And what reward you do have is eternal life. Hallelujah. Amen. Lord, have mercy. We might get to that on Sunday. We'll see. Come on, let's pray. Father, we love you. We do, God. And we want to learn from history. We want your Holy Spirit to convict us. We want you to teach us your ways so that we can live in a way that pleases you. So we can be a blessing to our brothers and sisters around us, the places that we have influence. So God, help us now to do those things that honor you. I pray your blessings over your people, God, for the time that they've come and spent in the Word, God. May you manifest yourself over their lives and show them great grace, hallelujah, for whatever it is that they're dealing with. We thank you for victory now for your people because of their faithfulness, for Jesus' sake. Amen. Amen. Come on, let's get ready to minister to the Lord in our giving on this evening. Amen. I trust that we've all given our lives to the Lord. If you're online and you haven't confessed with your mouth and believed your heart to Jesus, Lord, you just type in there, I need Christ. And somebody will minister to you on this evening. Amen. Come on, we're going to give and then we're going to be out of here. Hey, ain't faith. That's our love right there. Tracy Smith Boynton, good evening. Everything's gonna be alright. But either way, we're gonna be just fine. Yeah. This is one of y'all pastor's favorite songs. PJ Morton. It's gonna be Sunday, please pray for me and Thursday. We got some travel we got to do for the jurisdiction the next couple of days, but we'll be here Sunday. Praise the Lord. Singing and shouting. Somebody please tell my sister Angel that we'll be here Sunday. I'm supposed to report in for everywhere I'm going. All right, I love y'all. Have a great evening.